All right, here we go again. Everything that is being said here is only for the purpose of advancing a narrative. So if there's any little stumbles or details, etc., that you get stuck on, forget it. Forget it. Just set them aside and keep advancing along. The purpose of the narrative is to arrive at the realization that reality is not threatened by loss of any type. There is no loss in reality. That is the goal of the narrative. So it's the narrative, advancing the narrative is what's important. Not, you know, details and trying to fit all these details into some puzzle, etc., etc. No, that's not important. Not important. So here we are, advancing the narrative. And that's all important. Reality cannot suffer loss of any kind. It's not threatened by loss at all. So, what we're going to focus on first here is reality itself, to get a picture of what it is. It is what it is. If we could change even the slightest bit of reality, it would no longer be what it is. Okay, it's very key. Reality is what it is. Already is what it is. Even the slightest change would no longer be what it is. Let's say you have something, let's say reality was a situation where there was equal distribution of freedom everywhere. Perfect equal distribution. All of reality was saturated with this perfect equal distribution of perfect freedom. Okay, no exceptions. Now let's say we gave one tiny little aspect greater freedom. What would that mean? It would mean that all the rest would have lesser freedom. Or let's say we gave one little tiny fragment, if that were possible, just speaking hypothetically, less freedom. That means all the rest would have more freedom. You see? The equilibrium, the perfect equality would be gone. Reality is perfect equality. Perfect equality. That's what it is. That is what reality is. All of reality shares perfect equality, perfect freedom, perfect creativity. All of it shares the same capability, the same truth, operates under the same laws, the same rules, as it were. And there are no exceptions anywhere, ever. Endlessly, this is true. So make one exception, and you no longer have reality. You no longer have it. It's gone. It would be destroyed. It would not be there at all. This is what we struggle with, because we keep thinking, one little exception isn't such a big deal. In this world here, we're trying to establish loss. Let me back up just a second. I've said it many times, and let's keep after it, this narrative. In reality, we want it to be greater than God, greater than reality. We wanted to be the originators of it, and we're not. So therefore, that means we'd have to change reality. We'd have to change it. But if we change it in the tiniest bit, it is no longer what it is. Because reality is this perfect equality without any exception. That's what it is. So if we could change it in the slightest bit, it wouldn't be what it is. But if we want to be something different than what we are, we have to believe we can change it. So when we took up this idea of wanting to be greater than reality, to be the origin of reality, as it were, the prime creator, when we took that idea up, we had to believe that we can change reality. We'd have to, right? We'd have to change our position in reality. But remember, to change reality in any way, even the slightest way, would be to change all of it. All of it. And it would no longer be what it is at all. You could be unrecognizable. It is the perfect equality and the perfect freedom that brings about the carefreeness, the creativity, the flow, everything. No exceptions is what reality is all about. So, when we pursued this notion of changing reality so that we could be something different than what we are, we had to believe that it's possible to change reality. We had to believe it. And this is why we're so frightened, because deep down within us, we know if we could change even the tiniest, even in what we would call just a super, 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 super tiny bit, the tiniest fragment has some more or less, that reality would be no more. And so because we believe we can do this, otherwise we wouldn't pursue this idea, we believe our reality is going to be wiped out. And therefore we have to construct a new home. Okay, that is the deep fear that drives us. We're trying to construct a new reality, a new home for ourselves. We're trying to adapt ourselves to this existence. And existence is simply a loss-based scenario, a scenario where we are trying to come up with some sort of loss that will change reality. It's all symbolic. Existence is simply symbolic. We're symbolizing loss. More or less. What was, is no longer what it was. Constant change. Constant change. We're trying to basically destroy reality. We're trying to find a way to change reality, which would destroy it. And we stumble over the belief that pursuing a little tiny loss should be fine. That shouldn't be a problem. It's the big loss that we're supposed to stay away from, but the little tiny loss, that's okay. And here is the trouble. It's not okay. Pursuing the tiniest loss is really the most damning type of thing we can pursue for ourselves. Because again, even this tiniest loss would wipe out all reality, no longer be what it is. And so we think, well, a small loss, it shouldn't threaten reality at all, so that's no big deal. It's a totally big deal, if it were possible. It's not possible, though. So we tend to brush off, they say, it's just a little loss. How could a little loss hurt? That type of thing. No, a little change in reality would change all of reality. And no longer, it would no longer be reality at all. Even the tiniest change in what reality is. The most infinitesimal change imaginable still would be exactly the same as the greatest change imaginable. No difference whatsoever. No difference. So, when we look at existence, we see loss of all types, right? It's a sacrificial workshop, existence. But existence is trying to destroy itself. Trying to destroy itself, trying to annihilate itself, believing that this will bring about the annihilation of reality. It's trying to find, it's throwing everything up there, from the greatest loss to the tiniest loss, with the loss of a planet, a solar system, a galaxy, a universe, or the loss of the tiniest happiness, the tiniest irritation, any of that, you see. But the truth is that all loss is equally futile, and it would have the same exact effect. Big or small makes no difference. None to reality. The destruction of a universe, or the tiniest bit of fear or uncertainty or doubt or irritation, etc., exactly the same. It would be exactly the same. There's no difference. If reality can change, be changed in this any way, all of it would be changed, and it would no longer be what it is. It would vanish. This is super crucial to not spend time differentiating between different types of loss. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter at all. It's completely irrelevant. Reality cannot suffer loss of any kind. It's impossible. There is no will, there is no power to change what reality is at all. And so all the slicing and dicing, we set up this, you know, existence, this dream scenario, and we're going through all this loss. I mean, flesh forms, energy suffers all this loss. All these forms are being constructed and destructed. All a complete waste of time. Complete waste of time for us. Doesn't accomplish anything in reality. Reality is not threatened by this, and the teachers come into the world to show complete unconcern for what's happening here. Total unconcern. They just show us that they're not in the slightest bit concerned about anything that happens here, because none of this affects reality. All this loss that we're constantly engaging in, of all types, doesn't concern reality in the slightest bit. Reality is not, you know, like watching existence with concern at all. Maybe with a laugh. It laughs, but chuckles. But it's not watching. It's not watching existence. It's not monitoring existence. It's not concerned about all of this type of loss we keep, you know, boasting about. Say, look at all this loss that we can generate. Reality, I'm sure you must conclude that we can inflict at least a tiny bit of loss on you. See, here we go. Here we are in this loss factory of existence, right? And we're generating all this loss of every type of variety. You know, all these deaths and disintegration, everything's decaying. And we think, ha-ha, look at all this evidence at our power to inflict loss. Surely we conclude that we can at least inflict a tiny infinitesimal loss on reality, right? Surely we must be able to do that. But of course, if we could do that, we would have destroyed reality. So no, we cannot. No matter how much evidence we have for loss in a dream, we cannot take that dream evidence, that imaginary evidence, and conclude that therefore we can affect the real, what is real. So, this is we're again, we're advancing the narrative here, advancing it. Don't worry. Say, I can't quite get this. That's okay. Keep on trucking. Keep advancing the narrative. This universe, existence, is our imagination. It's a dreamlike scenario. We're imagining it, all this loss. We're inflicting loss upon symbols. Energy is neutral, but we use it to construct all these symbols, appearances, and then destroy the appearances, inflict loss upon these appearances, change, you know. And we are doing this to bolster our belief that we can change reality. So we are literally here witnessing to all this loss. We come into this world, we see nothing but loss. Sure, we see constructivity, but we know that everything that arises here will also suffer loss, everything. So we just, you know, move around our days and our lives, and everything's constantly changing. Or, you know, everything is, you know, we plant the plants in spring, they bloom, and then now some of them are starting to die, and as the autumn comes, everything, you know, will die, and changes are constantly taking place. Everyone's aging, changing their age, sickness, all levels. We're gaining some, losing some. You know, it's just this constant flux. But the purpose of it is loss, 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 loss. Change, 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 change. What was is no more. Okay, we are completely saturated by that and surrounded by this whole dream. Occasionally, you get a savior come into the world, and they are completely not focused on that. They don't even see it. They don't see loss at all. There has no interest to them whatsoever, and they just assure us that this dream scenario of loss is not threatening reality. Reality is unconcerned about it, and they radiate that unconcern of reality here. And some of us pick up on that and say, "Wait a minute, what's going on here?" This is our sacrificial workshop. Existence is our sacrificial workshop, and we are trying to generate evidence. Here's the funny thing: we realize at some level we can't change reality directly. Okay, what we're trying to do is we're trying to showcase this scenario, hypothetical scenario of loss, and we're trying to hold this up to reality, to the prime creator, to reality, and saying, look, reality, look at our power to afflict loss. And we say, you know what, I'll make a deal with you, reality. We will not destroy you entirely. In fact, we're not even going to destroy you, very much of you at all. And in fact, we're so benevolent and loving and kind and compassionate and gracious. We are only going to have you agree to a little destruction, a little loss, a little change. Just, as a matter of fact, the tiniest change. That's all we're so benevolent, that's all we're going to ask for. How about that? So we're literally asking reality to change itself to avoid a worse fate. We're bluffing. We're bluffing reality, okay? We come up here and we say, look at all the loss that we can afflict upon everything, you know. Look how we've done. We've slaughtered the innocents. We've spread disease and warfare and destruction. We are powerful, powerful destroyers. We've destroyed everything, you know. We go up to reality and say, okay, reality, I'll tell you what. We were going to destroy you entirely, but because we want you to flourish under our benevolence. We're going to be the prime creators now. But to show you how benevolent we are as prime creators, we are going to make a deal. And guess what? Instead of destroying all of reality, we're only asking you to change yourself in a tiny, tiny, tiny way. And we'll spare you. All the rest will be spared. Okay, that is literally what is going on. Directly, literally, the truth of the situation. We are trying to build up this power, bargaining power, over reality. We know we can't change reality, but we think we can scare reality into changing itself. We can scare the prime creator into changing itself by this bluff. And we think, you see, that we can trick the prime creator, because we know that if even a tiny, tiny little, the tiniest bit were changed in any way, the whole thing would be changed and it would be no more. And we think we're able to trick Prime Creator. And Prime Creator is just laughing, you know. It's funny. It's a joke. Therein lies the entire dynamic of existence, if you can see this. It's a bluff. We're bluffing. And if you see this, you don't need to keep accumulating all this power of destructivity, of loss, of change. Don't need to be surrounded by this evidence. Right now, we're accumulating. We want to put ourselves through greater and greater cycles of destruction, and so that we can feel like we can then go up to God, the prime creator of reality, and say, let's make a deal. I'll tell you what, We've got the big stick now. Look what we did. We've And you know, when the God says no deal, we go, wow. Well, next time the deal will be stronger. You know, we try to scare God that way. We say, the next time I come back, I'll even be more powerful destroyer, and I'll strike an even more severe deal. This is the best deal you're going to get. I'm only asking for the tiniest change. Tiniest change. Okay. And so we think, well, eventually the prime creator will cave in, you know. No. There's no possibility of that. There is no will to do that. God's, the prime creator's will is equally distributed throughout all of reality. So there is no such principle saying, well, you know what, I'm going to change some of reality a tiny little bit. It's not possible. It can never happen. So we are in this game of chicken with the prime creator, a game of bluff. We're bluffing. If we can see that we're bluffing, you know, then we're in a great position to give up this whole scenario. But we don't need to accumulate any more loss. We don't need any more evidence of our power of inflicting loss, of suffering loss. We don't need to go through that at all. Not at all. Which is why I say we are headed towards the loss-free realm, the paradise realm. Don't have any water here. Yeah, I have a tiny bit. Okay. This bears repeating. This bears repeating. Because if we see that we're bluffing, trying to bluff reality, and we see it's silly because it's a trick. We're trying to trick reality, and reality can't be tricked like that. Then there's no more need. The game is up. There's no more need for us to be accumulating all this evidence of loss so that we can think that we can carry out the bluff. We don't need it. Don't need it. So that has to put ourselves in an extremely good situation as far as allowing our experience then to be loss-free. No sickness, no dying, no destructivity, no vulnerability. We don't need any of that anymore. You see? That this repentance is simply to see that you've been trying to bluff reality and it will never work and you're willing to give it up. Give up the bluff. That's the best position you can be in. So again, let us recount this bluff. We want to build up our resume of loss as high as possible. Say, ah, I've died so many times. I've killed so many forms. I've destroyed so much. I've suffered so much destruction. I know destruction is real. I know it's true because I've been through so much and I've seen destruction of so much, you know, and I've been completely immersed in this massive display of destructivity. So I know it's true. So reality, prime creator, I know that I've got this enormous power and I can even destroy all of reality. And I'm going to do it. But I'll tell you what, since I'm going to be the new prime creator, I want to show my vast benevolence. My benevolence is unbelievable. My compassion is unbelievable. My love is unbelievable. And therefore, I am going to spare all of reality from this destructivity except a tiny, 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 tiny fraction. I need that little tiny bit just of compliance. I want you to change just a little bit as a gesture of goodwill and submission to this new authority that is here now. But you see how compassionate. I'm only asking for the tiniest, tiniest bit. So what a deal, right? You got to accept that deal. And the prime creator says, you know, it's not possible. If the tiniest bit of reality were changed, all of reality would vanish. Right? And then we go crazy. So what are you talking about? You know, how ungracious can you be? You don't even want to, you know, acknowledge my power of destructivity and loss, even a tiniest bit. And then we're furious, you know, and say, well, we're going to go accumulate even more loss and then come back and really sock it to you. So we get furious. So you wonder why we keep reincarnating into loss. Because we keep accumulating more loss. With each incarnation, we accumulate more and more loss. And even on the subtle levels, we accumulate more and more loss. And what happens is we eventually get to the point where we do try to bluff reality, and it doesn't work, and we get angry, say, doggone it. And then that propels us back through another cycle of collecting more loss. We say, well, we didn't have enough power to get God to agree to changing a tiny, tiny bit of reality, so we need more experience in loss in order to get this. And so we simply cycle like this, you know, through all these cycles and cycles and cycles and cycles. Each time, you know, at some point we offer this deal to reality, and reality doesn't accept the deal, and that pushes us back. Then we get angry. We say, gosh, we got to get more loss. So we keep cycling through existence like this. And so how to break free of these cycles of existence? It's right here, just presented to you. See that it's a bluff that will never be accepted. Because what we're really offering the reality is total destruction, annihilation of reality. And we're packaging it in this seemingly very benign way of saying, well, we're only asking for just the tiniest little change. See? And we think that, you know, we're very clever and smart about that. We're trying to trick reality. Reality cannot be tricked. Reality knows perfectly well of the equality of all of reality without any exception. Make one exception, reality is no more. Period. So our bluff cannot work. It cannot work. So what we need to do is say, Prime Creator, I've been trying to bluff you all this time, you know, by accumulating this power of loss and then offering you this deal, thinking I can trick you into changing a little bit to save the rest of it. And I realize that this is just nothing but a total bluff on my part. And I know you'll never accept it, because it would be the destruction of all reality. And so, hey, I'm admitting, you know, I'm confessing, this is what I've been up to. And the Prime Creator will say, yeah, I know, that's great. Welcome home. Welcome back. That's it. Prime Creator has always known what we're up to. And, it's not the slightest possibility that it would ever come to any fruition. So it's just waiting for us to realize this. That's repentance. That's salvation. That's what it is in a nutshell. It doesn't need to be anything more complicated than that. I mean, you have to advance the narrative, you know, to this point. Seeing the total picture. Why are we vulnerable to loss here in this existence? Because that we are accumulating evidence of vulnerability to loss. We are accumulating it. And that's what we're seeking. You ever wonder why we get all this news about all this loss and terrible stuff? Because that's what we're seeking. And even when we're victimized by others, that's because that's what we're seeking. We're seeking, you know, victims are seeking victimization to pad their resume of vulnerability. So they can go up to the Prime Creator and say, Prime Creator, look, I have all this massive resume. Look what happened to me. I suffered terrible loss. I was victimized in so many ways. You see? So I have this power of vulnerability, and I'm going to inflict this power upon all of reality if you don't make this deal. That's what's happening. And it goes both ways. Those ones that suffer, you know, victimization, all of that, they're establishing that the notion that something is vulnerable to destructivity or loss. Okay, so they say, look, how can you say that's not true? Look what happened to my life. Look what happened to my life. Of course, life is vulnerable to loss and destruction. Of course it is. Look at my resume. Look at my resume. Look what happened to me. And the Prime Creator just smiles, because the Prime Creator knows what's coming. And they say, look, this power of loss will be inflicted on all reality. But if you make this little deal, the rest will be spared. The rest will be spared. There you go. So now you know the whole picture: victimization, whether you're being victim or victimizer, whatever the vulnerability, loss, vulnerability, suffering, misery, loss, all this stuff. We're just padding our resume. That's all that it is. 100%, that's all that it is. It has no other purpose or significance. We're padding our resume so that we can finally, we think, end this cycle and become Prime Creator by getting the real Prime Creator to agree to our deal of changing just a little tiny bit of reality. And that will never happen. So there is no amount of resume padding that's ever going to make any difference. So why continue to pad your resume? See, why? And if you say, you know what, I don't want to pad my resume, it's futile, it's useless, that puts you in prime position to sidestep the activity of those who do want to continue to pad their resume. That's it. Say, I don't want to be victimized. I don't want to victimize anyone. I don't want to be victimized. I don't want to suffer loss. I don't want to pad my resume because I know it's futile. So I keep doing what's futile. It's ridiculous. That puts you in the prime position to sidestep. Put you in prime position to be what's called in paradise or the loss-free realm. The realm where there is no evidence of vulnerability or loss whatsoever. The place where you cannot pad your resume of at all. But you see, if you realize, you know, if you don't want to pad your resume because you know it's futile, you say, thank you. This is what I want. This is what I really want. And that's the halfway house back to reality. Whereas you begin to again feel what reality is, the invulnerability of reality, the carefreeness. You're being rehabilitated to that. So then you can flow with it like you were created to flow with it in perfect freedom and spontaneity and creativity. And so there is a great difference between those who want to continue to pad their resume, thinking that if they just get a little bit more, they're going to have enough. That's always the hook, isn't it? Existence has this hook. And that hook is, we must be really close by now. So just a little more, this one is going to do it for sure. We're going to accumulate a ton. You know, the loss, the sacrificial scenario that's coming upon this planet is massive. And that's why everybody here is kind of eager, like they're saying, come on, you know, bring it on. Let's get to it. Because they realize the opportunity to pad their resume is going to be extraordinary. Not only their own loss of their life, but loss of everybody else's life. Not only loss of life, but brutal suffering of every type. Horrible afflictions. Everything's going to be poured out upon this planet. And everybody, 7 billion people are here because they want to be here, because they want to pad their resumes. They see this as a fantastic opportunity to pad their resumes, even to the point they believe that they're finally going to get God to accept this deal that they're offering. God, you know, what a deal. And they think, this will do it. This will do it for sure. So they're you know, they're all here. They're all waiting for it, you know, and it's very close. You know, if you think that, no, the world doesn't... The attitude of the world, most here in this world, they are here because, who's this? Mailman, okay, to pad their resumes. And they know this is a fantastic opportunity for that. Otherwise, they wouldn't be here, you see. Or they're here, just 1 minute. Or they're here to explain the way to freedom, the way to safety, the way to be freed, the way, the path of repentance, to how to get free of padding your resume, to see that there's a choice. You can either choose to pad your resume or not pad your resume. And if you really repent, Like Jesus said, you're in paradise. You'll be in paradise, meaning the loss-free realm. There is such a realm, because I have experienced it, where there's not loss of any, no vulnerability, no loss at all. The only change is not a change of what is, as far as something losing something, but just the expansion, as it were. But it is a wonderful place where you, but you cannot pad your resume there, of loss, of vulnerability, of change, of destructivity. You can't pad it there at all. There's no opportunity for that. So therein lies the whole situation. If you go in that direction, you can go in that direction, or you can continue with the padding your resume of loss. And again, the opportunity to pad our resume of loss and vulnerability and destruction is so extreme at this time. The opportunity will be so extreme that most here in the world cannot pass that by. They just can't. Because they think, wow, you know, I might regret it. I really might regret it. Because this is like a granddaddy of loss. This is like the opportunity. Opportunity like this won't come along again in a long, long time, to be immersed in so much loss and vulnerability and destruction and affliction and misery and all this, to just see an entire planet engulfed in it. And on and on and on and on, to the point where the entire planet will be in flames and melting. And, you know, just the whole scenario that's ahead of us here is one of so much levels of loss, just loss upon loss upon loss upon loss upon loss. It's just a veritable feast. It's a resume padding dream, you know. It's a, what do you call it? It's those who want to pad their resumes, greatest hope, you know, greatest opportunity. They see it as the ultimate in resume padding. How to pad that resume with loss, so they can say, God, I know loss. I have the power. I know it's true, because look at my resume. How can you possibly deny my resume? Look at everything I've gone through. You see? So this is an opportunity for those who want to pad their resume to receive an enormous padding of their resume. Almost irresistible. Almost irresistible. And I have to say, even for me, it's almost irresistible. You know, I'm sitting like, you know, gosh, do I really want to miss this, you know, incredible opportunity to pad my resume? Because this is going to, you know, put us over the top, as it were. You know, all those deaths and dyings in the past and sufferings and miseries, etc. So many, many, many. And yet here's this opportunity to see it on a global scale, 7 billion people and the planet, everything. Oh my gosh, you know, it seems like this would just, you know, put us over the top. So almost everyone on this planet, unless you're a savior, is sorely tempted by this. Sorely tempted by it. Really. And the purpose of these videos is to take the edge off that temptation. Not to say that's not there. Of course it's there. We think we want it. Absolutely, we think we want it, because we think it is our salvation. We think that this padding of our resume is our salvation, because we think, we believe our salvation is to get God to agree to our deal. We absolutely think that, and believe and trust and have faith that this is true. So, of course, from that standpoint, we want it. But from what standpoint of what we really want is to realize this won't work. And therefore, repent and be returned, have this wonderful homecoming, as it were. Coming back home, realizing it's always been home, always will be home for us, you see. And we don't need to create a new home. That's what we really want. So there's a struggle between what we really want and what we think we want. See, two versions of salvation. One is that by padding our resume sufficiently, we'll finally get the Prime Creator to agree to our demands, and then therefore the whole scenario will be over with and we won't need any more suffering or loss or anything. We will then live in a glorious new reality, as it were. That's those who continue to pad the resume, that's what they believe. Belief is placed there. But the voice of reason, which comes from Prime Creator, tells us, you know, that's futile. It will never work. No amount of padding your resume is going to work at all. Whether you have a little bit or infinite bit of loss doesn't make any difference. So you're simply wasting your time. So the voice of reason points this out. And then we say, wait a minute, I get to choose between what I want and what I really want. Between belief and faith and hope and the voice of reason that came from Prime Creator telling us the truth. We get to choose. And we're at that time where it's important to choose. And again, it's very important to realize that just because you choose to abide in the loss-free world, paradise, to be saved, to repent and be saved, and choose not to pad your resume anymore, not to try to do that. That doesn't mean that there isn't part of you that still wants to, thinks it wants to. You know, it's at this point, it's still there. It's still there. It's still saying, no, I want to pay attention to the wars and all this stuff that's happening. I want to see, you know, the deaths and the dying and the sickness. I want to pay attention to this. That's still there. But there's a part of you, stronger part, that says, you know, it's still there, but the overall choice, the scales are tipping, you know, in this direction, that no more resume padding. It's all futile. Let us move in the direction of the loss-free realm. Move in the direction of paradise, as it were. Move towards being immersed in that which doesn't pad our resume of loss in the slightest bit, where there's no loss, no vulnerability, incredible beauty that is unconcerned, not vulnerable to any sort of destruction of any type. No beetles are going to bore into the trees and destroy them, you see. And so, again, don't fight against that part of you that thinks it wants to pad its resume. Don't fight against it. Don't get angry. Don't fight against it. Just realize it's there. Just see why it's there. What its purpose is. And by seeing what its purpose is, then you automatically, you'll have the, you will tilt the scales, you know. You'll tilt the scales in the direction of freedom from loss, freedom from trying to pad your resume, just by looking at it. Now, don't get angry, don't fight, don't say, what's the matter with me? And don't indulge it. And even if it gains, like after this taping, that part will say, okay, you had your time, now I want my time. I want to, you know, go look at the obituaries or something. And they start, you know, looking, oh, look at this. This person was shot up there, and the car accident here, and ain't it awful, you know, and all this stuff. And that's what it wants to do. It wants to keep padding its resume because it feels kind of, you know, like, wow, maybe this isn't working so good. So just try to minimize that if possible. Minimize it. You can't necessarily stamp it out, not really, at this point. And you shouldn't need to stamp it out. What you need to do is move in the direction towards, allow yourself to be attracted and pulled in the direction of the loss-free experience, where no resume padding is possible. Because you've seen the bluff. You've seen what you're doing, little fly. You've seen you're trying to trick God by presenting what seems to be an unbelievably great deal for reality. Unbelievably great deal. You can't believe. You know, when we get frustrated here, we're waiting. What are we waiting for? We're waiting for God to accept our deal. That's what we're waiting for. And we think, my gosh, I can't possibly give God a better deal. You know, this is like the ultimate deal. What's taking God so long? We just think, well, for sure, maybe God's just thinking it over. That's what we think. We think, you know, Prime Creator has this perfect deal on the table, and it's just like having a hard time realizing how great it is. I think that's how we spin it. We say, you know, it's taking Prime Creator a long time to agree to this deal because the Prime Creator is shocked and stunned of what a great deal it is. And it's kind of saying, is this really true? I mean, are you really giving me this fabulous deal? I can't believe it. You could destroy all of reality, and here you are only asking me to change a little bit and so I can be in control of it instead of you imposing it. Wow. I'm stunned by what you're magnanimous, gracious offer, and I'm having a hard time even accepting it because I feel like, you know, I'm taking advantage of you. You know, that's what we think. So we're just waiting for Prime Creator to accept the deal. Just waiting here. So any day now, Prime Creator will accept this deal. Any day, because how could it not? And then another thing is we think that because all this loss is coming, that's going to empower us even more, that Prime Creator is finally going to buckle. Right before this great planetary sacrifice, Prime Creator is going to say, okay, I'll accept your deal. I don't want you to get more powerful, because then you may withdraw the offer and say, forget it, I'm going to destroy all of reality because you didn't take it in time. Now I'm, you know, 10,000 times more powerful, and I'm decided, you know what, no deal. No more deal. Deal's off the table. So we're waiting for that. We're thinking Prime Creator's going to cave. At any moment now, it's going to cave. And of course, that will never happen. That will never happen. So we think we're going to avert maybe these catastrophes, all these troubles that are coming, simply because the Prime Creator, we believe the Prime Creator is going to cave in at the last second, saying, okay. No, I'll accept your deal. I don't want you to get more powerful. You might take the deal off the table. So that is what we're doing. And that will never happen. So this affliction that we're planning, you know, is going to take place unless we repent and give up the whole, you know, notion that this will ever be successful. And there... hypothetically, there are other ways we can say, you know what, Prime Creator didn't cave, so we're going to build up an even greater scenario of loss, etc., which is, you know, hypothetical. But I would bet that it is going to take place. I would say it is. But at any rate, the Prime Creator is not going to cave. You know, it's not like we're teetering on the edge of the cliff. You know, we're teetering right now. Planet is teetering. It is really teetering on the edge, on the brink. It's on the brink. We've been on the brink for a while, and we're now starting to lean over. You know, we're on the brink. Now we're starting to lean over, and we're ready to, we're just ready to fall like this, and we're waiting to see if the Prime Creator will crack. Will crack. We'll finally say, okay, I'll make the deal. You got a deal. Prime Creator cannot crack. There is no deal. There is no deal that can ever be made with reality. There is no deal ever. And the thing is, we've put the deal makers in charge of this planet, thinking, you see, that this will crack the Prime Creator. So when you ask yourself, why are we in such a horrible situation here? We've got these etheric vampires, this whole realm, etheric realm that is just sucking our energy. We've got so much stuff going on the planet of tyranny. You've got unbelievable drive towards decadence and decay and loss of freedom. And we realize, oh my gosh, we've placed all these people in charge of our lives. We've put all these people, we've allowed ourselves this situation to take place. Why? Because those ones who are in these positions of power are the deal makers, as it were. And we see them as being very tricky, very smart. And they're saying, don't worry. They say, we're setting all this up, this catastrophe up. We're putting you on the edge, we're putting you on the brink, and we're ready to push you over, only to try and get the Prime Creator to cave, you know. But the Prime Creator cannot cave, and the momentum of everything we've done. You know, the deal makers are going to say, okay, we need to push it a little further, so you need to be pushed over the cliff. And what the deal makers will say is, well, we need to at least push someone over. Let's start pushing one, two, three, you know, start this, and say and the prime creator will cave at any moment. They'll cave, so let's start the process, sacrificial process, going. But once it gets going, it starts expanding, right? Because it still doesn't work, and before you know it, the whole thing is in chaos. We put these clever deal makers in charge of the planet. We allowed it to happen because we want the deal to go through too. You see, everyone does. It'll never go through, so we don't need to put ourselves under the influence of these deal makers. Don't need to. And these deal makers will be, you know, pressing everyone here. You know, they say, somebody sacrifice yourself. You know, somebody bring about a severe sacrifice, which is why we're having these outbursts now all over the place. You know, somebody, please, the prime creator's ready to break. You know, we know it's right on the edge. The prime creator's ready to break. Let's start pushing things. Boom, 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 boom. And, you know, situation after situation after situation, people, you know, sacrifice their lives. They go, you know, through all sorts of suicides, you name it. All this stuff is, again, they're being asked to do this. And come on, you know, you need to do this to push the deal through. And since the deal can never be pushed through, that attitude that we must push it through will just continue to push and push and push everybody over the edge, you know, like lemmings. That's how it works. That is how it works. You know, that's like every day we get up in the morning and there's been another mass shooting somewhere, you know, some, you know, crazy thing. People are being pushed. They're being pushed. Try to get God to agree to the deal. The way out of this is to realize that God will never agree to any deal. It's all futile. All this pushing, the idea that we're pushing prime creator over the brink so the deal is done, is delusion. There is no brink. Prime creator is not on the brink of anything. Prime creator is still perfectly unconcerned and doesn't entertain these offers of deals at all. It just laughs. It says, hey, there's a way to repent. Just repent. That's all the prime creator says. Just repent. There is no deal. You can't make any deal. You should know that. You are one with reality. You were created as reality yourself. You know how reality is. You know you can't change even the tiniest bit. So give up this. You know you're bluffing. So give it up. You don't need to pad your resume. And the idea that we all need to cooperate, you know, group sacrifice. Let's collectively pad our resume. If we all engage in this massive sacrifice, then that will make the deal go through. Not true. That has just had zero chance, just as every other situation has zero chance. None, zero. All attempts to get the prime creator to agree to a deal are equally futile. Zero. Whether, doesn't matter whether one person dies or collectively 7 billion people die together. Makes zero difference. None. So why even engage in it at all? All it does is perpetuate the delusion. If you participate in it, it means you agree that yeah, this could work. This could work. And you strengthen, you know, people look at you and say, oh, see, you believe it too, right? And if you say, no, I don't, I say, well, look, you're engaging in loss and sacrifice and you're suffering all this stuff, so you must believe in it. And if you believe in it, why should I not believe in it? You know, so people say, well, Jesus was crucified. He must have believed it, but he was resurrected. And King Max said, look, I only did this to point out what you're trying to do. You're trying to gain leverage. You're trying to go to God and say, prime creator, look, I was able to sacrifice your son. Okay. in the flesh. Son was in the flesh. I killed the body. That shows I have this. I can destroy reality. So now let's make a deal. And Jesus was just pointing this out. God allowed this lesson to take place, and then was resurrected and said, "Look, see, here I am. You didn't destroy me. What I am, you didn't destroy what I am at all. You didn't destroy my spirit. You didn't touch my spirit. You just touched the flesh. But flesh is just a symbol, symbolic. It's nothing. And now you should know what you're trying to do. You're trying to gain leverage over reality, over prime creator." And so many believe that, you know, they can go to the prime creator and say, "Prime creator, we killed Jesus. So you have to make a deal now, because that just proves we could destroy you as well." But they forget, well, wait a minute. No, we destroyed the body. But then Jesus pointed out that the body is nothing. It's not the spirit. The spirit cannot be touched. And reality is not bodies, not flesh. But it should clue us in to what we're trying to do. We're trying to bluff God. We're trying to bluff God. You know, if you take it that way, then, you know, you've got repentance. We want the sacrifice to be significant, you know. 7 billion people dying in all different terrible ways. Going through, you know, displacement, starvation, imprisonment. I mean, just, you know, this place is going to be a chamber of horrors. All to pad our resumes. Okay, and everything that happens, people are saying, "Okay, I agree to this because I see how that's going to pad our resume." You know, and since we're all one, you know, whoever is the victim or victimizer is the same thing. It's resume padding of this idea, this notion, of this belief. It's the belief, it's the idea of trying to change reality that's in charge, and it's the belief that drives us. So we say, "Well, it doesn't matter who is killed and who kills. The ultimate goal is to pad the resume of loss. That's something that life can die." Okay, so it doesn't really matter what role we play in that, which is why I've always said that victim and victimizer are collaborators, because the purpose is to pad the resume of loss. So it doesn't matter what role you play at all. It makes no difference. What matters is that the resume of loss is padded, so that then this can be presented to Prime Creator. The Spirit can present this and say, "Look, you see? Look what happened there. Loss took place. Loss took place." That's why I don't judge, you know, who's good and who's bad, because it's a dance of collaboration. It is a dance of collaboration. And when we want to pad the resume of loss severely, we those in charge who are able to, you know, wield the hammers and the knives, you know, who can do the dirty work, and the rest of us, you know, suffer all this terrible loss, as it were. But the overall effect is the resume, the total resume of existence gets padded, right? And also, we pad our personal resume too. Either way, we say, either say, "Look who I struck down. I struck down all this life." Or the life will say, "Look, I was life and I got struck down. That means you, reality, you must be vulnerable to being struck down too." Same thing. It's the same thing. No matter what side of the coin you're on, it's the same thing. It's simply resume padding. Very great, you see. And we don't need to play either role. We don't need to be the victim, and we don't need to be the victimizer. Two sides of one coin, collaboration of resume padding. We can get out of that whole scenario. No resume padding means no victim and no victimizer. Either one. An experience of peace, invulnerability, loss-free situation. Paradise, loss-free realm, the realm that is suffers no loss whatsoever. Zero resume padding. We can't experience that literally. We think, "Oh, that's impossible." All it takes is this clarity. That's all that it takes. Is to simply repent. Say, repent means to say, "Ah, Prime Creator, reality, however you want to say it, God, whatever, source, say source, I acknowledge, I see what I've been trying to do, and I see it'll never work. So, you know, game's up. Let's move past that now. That's it. No more deals. No more attempt to make deals. So give me an experience where there is no resume forming at all. No resume of vulnerability, loss, destruction, none. And that, I know I need that to rehabilitate my continuity back to, you know, the flow of reality, because I've been in this, I'm so familiar with this parameters of this loss game, this resume game I'm playing, that I'd like to have sort of a reflection of reality first and get used to it. And that's the plan. That's the plan. And that, so you then will move in that direction. We'll move in that direction, and you don't even need to pay attention to what the world is doing anymore. Jesus said, "Let the dead bury the dead." I mean, let the dead pay attention to what the dead are doing. You who have repented don't need to pay any more attention, because you don't need to pat. You're not interested in padding your resume. Serves no purpose. Serves no purpose. And if you do pay attention to it, and you're actually doing what everyone wants. People here, when they're suffering and dying, etc., they're doing it because, one, to pad their own resume, two, to pad the collective resume, and they want you to witness to it and see it and feel the loss and feel, oh, isn't that awful, terrible loss, etc. They want you to be witness to it, bear witness to it. That pads the resume. You don't have to bear witness to any loss, because you've repented. You realize it's futile. You have the right to recognize futility. You have that right. And no one has the right to deny that to you. And if they resist it and get angry, it's because they feel that by padding their resume, by you witnessing to their loss or loss, that they'll pad the collective resume, and that is their salvation. So they believe you're holding them back, delaying their salvation. It's not true. By not paying attention to it, you actually are lessening the delay, because deep within them, they'll say, wait a minute, you know, somebody just said no, repented and said, this is has no, can't make a deal at all. And that'll, at some level, even though it's covered by fog, that's there, and it's expanding, and so it lessens delay greatly by turning away from it and not bearing witness to any scenario of loss. It lessens delay greatly, and by paying attention to it, it only lengthens delay. It only lengthens it, because that plan of salvation, of getting God to agree to a deal, will never work. So those who keep pursuing that are simply delaying the inevitable of a realization that it will never work. They're simply delaying it. So don't contribute to the delay. Contribute to the lessening of the delay. The shortening of the delay. Contribute to that by accepting, going in the direction of a loss-free experience. Going in that direction. So again, let your narrative, your own narrative, your life, go in that direction. And say, I don't need to pay attention to all this stuff, you know, on the news, and ain't it awful, and all this stuff. It's not important. I don't need to pay attention to that. Now, there are some who act as though they're above it all in this world, because they're the ones who feel that the others are going to suffer loss and not them, and that they're here to inflict the loss, as it were, to get God to agree to a deal. So that they're, you see the attitude of many in this world of, we're not concerned, you know, we're not concerned. There's several attitudes in the world I've seen. There are those who are acting happy. They're like, wow, this world's great, everything's fine, because they know it's going towards loss, and that's what they want. So they seem like everything's on track. Most people are like that. Everything's on track. There are others who simply are paying no attention to loss, kind of like, oh, you know, and it seems like they're moving towards repentance, but what it is, they feel that they're elite in some way. They're entitled to not suffer loss. Others are going to suffer, but not them. You know, not that they've repented or moving towards repentance, just thinking that, well, it's the job of others to suffer loss, and then God will agree to the deal, and then they will, you know, benefit from that. That's not real repentance. And then there are those who see clearly what true repentance is. So you have slightly different, you know, attitudes in the world, where you might have a lot of people feeling very confident and positive, but for, you know, three different reasons. One, that because the people are, they want to experience all this loss because they think that's their salvation. Two, there are those who feel that, yeah, all this loss is going to happen and they're going to witness it, but they themselves are not going to suffer. And then three, there are those who turn their back on the whole scenario entirely and be translated into paradise, that this whole scenario will pass them by, automatically pass them by, and they'll find themselves in the loss-free realm. So those are the differences, some of the major differences in this world. It's not that everything is going to be okay here in this world. That is not true. There's going to be incredible misery and suffering and sacrifice in this world. Let it be. Don't. Why fight against it? It doesn't do anything. It has no effect. It doesn't bring God closer to a deal. So you don't need to say, "Whoa, wait a minute." You know, I don't want God to agree to that deal. So I better try and make things better in this world. Otherwise, God's going to agree to a deal. Not true. Whether this whole planet is destroyed or not makes no difference as far as God's concerned. As far as the deal is concerned, there is no deal on the table. From God's standpoint, there is no deal on the table. So the do-gooders in this world, they're worried. They say, whoa, I don't want reality to be destroyed. I don't want God to agree to this deal, so we better minimize loss here. You know, let's pare down our resume, as it were. Let's stop this fighting. Let's stop this violence. Let's make a beautiful world here. Come on, people. You know, they're nervous that God might agree to the deal and reality be destroyed. That is still total delusion. There is no deal on the table with God. None. So it doesn't matter what happens in existence. Whether this planet is a utopia, whether it's destroyed, or whatever happens, there is no deal on the table. So you don't have to spend your time trying to bring peace here. And furthermore, everything on the planet is constantly changing and decaying anyway, so the evidence for loss and destruction is still, you know, constantly taking place here. So everyone's padding their resume here, whether there's a war taking place or not. And everybody is, whether people are dying here or not, they're going to die for sure at some point here. So it's a gesture of futility to try and be the peacemaker, as it were, because that is driven by delusion. It is equally delusional to try and bluff God into a deal, or to say, whoa, let's not bluff God because we're afraid he's going to accept it. That's equally delusional. That still is saying, yes, God can be brought to agree to change a bit of reality. So we need to defend against that. That's equally delusional. You see? Equally delusional. Peacemakers are equally delusional to the war makers. Equally delusional. Same delusion. There is no deal. God cannot change even the tiniest bit of reality. Never will. Never will be any deal. So God is completely indifferent to whatever, whenever we're talking about a deal or defending him, God, against a deal. Completely indifferent to that. That is simply ludicrous. So whether there's peace or war on this planet, God is not paying any attention to any of that. And even if there were peace here, the constant decay in this planet and loss, there's, you know, insects are dying constantly, fish dying, birds, mammals, bacteria of all types, microorganisms, flora and fauna of all types, everything on this planet. Rocks are decaying. Everything is decaying. And then this cycle of decay puts forth something new to decay again. So we're immersed in padding our resume here, whether there's wars or not, whether there's war or peace, we're still completely immersed in it. It's just that when we have super intense destructivity here, there is a opportunity to pad our resume in that way, which is above how we normally are padding it, you see. So all this stuff that is to come on this planet is like an intense padding. We think it's going to be the final straw that breaks Prime Creator's back. And there are those who are shaken and worried, say, oh my gosh, no, we must prevent this, we must prevent it. Because if Prime Creator's back is broken, reality will be destroyed, will be destroyed, oh my gosh. You know, they're scared of it. So gotta stop it. No. From Prime Creator, there is no deal on the table. There are no straws being added up. There is no resume being presented. It's just completely, laughs. It's a joke. It's a funny joke, is all. No deal. Prime Creator cannot change reality at all. Not even the slightest bit. Can never be changed. So, no possibility. No deal. However we try to spin it. You know, however we try to spin it. So, again, the unconcern. The unconcern of reality towards whatever we do here. Total unconcern. Brings us to repentance, realizing, I'm just trying to pad the resume some in one way or the other. Even by trying to stop the padding of the resume. See, I'm not trying to stop the padding of the resume of anyone who wants to do it. I'm just saying it's futile. So why engage in futility is all I'm saying. I'm not saying it should be stopped because it might cause Prime Creator to agree to the deal. No. No, that would be insanity. That would be delusion. I'm just saying, go ahead. You know, if everyone wants to pad their resume, you know, I'm saying there's no concern one way or the other. However, it is foolish. It is futile. That's all I'm saying. I'm saying it's futile and it's foolish. Because it's futile, it's foolish. Unless you just think it's fun or something, you know. But you don't really think that. You might want to think that, but nobody's really having fun. Not really. No way. Because it's fear. It's fear-based. You know, there's this, no matter how you candy coat it with love and affection, it's still fear-based. You still have this deep fear, like, oh, what if this works? What if it works? Maybe I'll be annihilated. What if it works? You know, which would be true. If it did work, you would be annihilated. But it can't work. So it's futile, and it's folly. It's foolish. It's a waste of time. It's not what we really want. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. No judgment. You know, what is there to judge? What can you judge futility other than foolishness? That's all. It's just silly. It's just silly. That's what it really is. I mean, but other than that, there's no other judgment of it on people. Whoever wants to continue on with this saga, you know, of vulnerability and loss and destructivity, well, you know, doesn't change reality in the slightest bit. Doesn't change reality at all. If that's, you know, that's what they want to do. That's what they want to do. But I will never say that it isn't futile. I'll never say it's not foolish. Silly, whimsical, futile. If those want to say, oh yeah, but it's really fun, we love it, oh, well, whatever. I'm still saying the same thing. That it's futile, and eventually you must repent. Those are facts. They're not judgments, they're facts. We're not talking about judgment, judging, relative judgments. We're talking about facts. Facts are not judgment. And the facts are it's futile. And the fact is that everyone will eventually say, this is not what I really want. And we're all entitled to what we really want. Those are facts. And facts, we can't have it otherwise. We are one with reality. We are that. Okay? And our being is under the laws of reality. Always will be. That's a fact. So we must accept this at some point. And we're all entitled to accept it right now. We're all entitled to accept it right now. Totally. Solidarity with insanity is no solidarity at all. Okay? It was never there. Loyalty to insanity is no loyalty at all. It was never there. It was a promise to be loyal in the future. And that promise continually gets pushed into the future, and it's never there. It's never there now. It's not here. It's not here now. All the agreements are not here now. It's all only in the future, and they're continually pushed into the future. So we say, yeah, let's solidarity, loyalty, let's all go along with this, and that's always in the future. There is no solidarity now, none. Because nobody really wants this, no one. And all this thinking that we want it, it's actually projected into the future. We don't want it, we don't really want it now at all. So we're thinking that in the future we will want it. But when we, right now, we don't really want it. And right now is always right now. I mean, so we never really want it. We never really want it. Only imagine in the future that we will really want it. Because we imagine it will succeed and we'll be prime creator, and that's what we really want. We think that's what we really want. But how can we really want something that can never take place? Consider that. Can we ever really want that which is futile? We'll never be. That's like saying we really want non-being, which is, we don't really want that. So we keep saying, well, yeah, we don't want it right now. We don't really want it right now, but very soon we will. This whole plan will succeed, and then we will get what we really want. So that keeps us bound. You know, we keep saying, okay, I'll keep hanging in there. That's where the whole be here now thing ties in with all of this. Accept what you really want now, instead of what you think you're going to want in the future, because it's a trick. Because when we arrive at this future, like look, yesterday we arrived at today, we asked what do we really want? Do we really want to non-being? The answer is no, we don't. No. So what we really want right now is the same as what we really wanted yesterday and the day before and the day before and the day before, always. So how do we think that somehow it's going to be different in the future? Because we think that this deal with God is going to go through. That is why we keep getting strung along day after day after day. And something's saying this, no, you'll get, if you just hang in there, you'll get what you really want. And they say, what, you know, how's that? Well, because the deal will go through. That's what we tell ourselves. The deal will go through. And it won't. Deal will not go through. There is no deal. There is no deal. There is no deal at all. And the more we recognize this, the more we realize, oh, wait a minute, what I want really now? What do I want really now? And that's the loss-free experience. That's what you want really now. And they think, well, why am I waiting then? Because we think that God will finally agree to this deal. That's why we're waiting. That'll never happen. Which is why all our days of our lives we have been in this situation. You realize the situation's the same that you're in. Same old, same old, same old. I can testify to this. I'm in the exact same situation as I've always been. I feel exactly the same situation. No matter what changes, you know, happen around me, I feel exactly the same. I'm waiting for something. Waiting for what I really want. Waiting will never bring it about. Because the deal will never go down. You see, we have to put it in the future, right? Because it can't go down right now. We know that it's not going down now. So we have, our belief has to put it in the future. has to say, well, it will. It just, you know, tomorrow. It'll go down tomorrow. Maybe later today. Just not now. No. It's not right now. It can never go. It can never happen. So it can't be experienced now. See, we have to say it's in the future. That's why you're not experiencing it now. No, it's in the future. We'll experience it in the future. Of course, you arrive at the future. Here you are right now, and it's not there now. We're just tricking ourselves, you know, stringing ourselves along that way. And, you know, different people will have different approaches. Some will focus on this time and now thing, which can definitely work. Others will focus on the theory of it, which is what I mainly do. And at some point, they'll come together, you know, and just the whole epiphany, you know, will be there, like, aha, you know, that's it. And you know, the doors to paradise then will open. They'll be there. And it's even possible, and when you're in this world, to be seeing the paradise in this world, the loss free realm, no loss, everything's overlaid. It's possible. No matter what seems to suffer loss in this world, you're experiencing this overlay that is suffering no loss. That's very doable here. But I would think that it is very likely there will be a translation into the loss-free realm at some point coming up here for those who don't want to go through all this loss-based scenario. Either way. But what I have seen is that it's very likely there will be this Passover situation where the whole scenario of loss, of resume padding, will automatically pass by those who don't want that repented, and that they will then find themselves being gently translated, awareness will dawn of the loss-free realm. We don't have to worry about, you know, how that happens, because it's something that happens automatically when you have the right orientation, automatically. So we're just working on the right orientation. Right orientation at this point, because the pushes are happening. You know, you can see people are being pushed all the time. You say, why did somebody do that? Great, because they were pushed from the deal makers. The deal makers said, hey, it's time to push God a little bit here. Come on, let's go. You're up. You know, it's your turn at bat. You know, your turn to start inflicting loss and be pushed. And so people are being pushed all the time. And not only people, but countries will eventually be pushed. Pushed into war, pushed into conflict. Politicians will be pushed into draconian laws and decrees and all sorts of stuff. Everyone will be pushed more and more and more down this path of sacrifice, of resume padding. And so we want to get oriented in the right direction. So when all these pushes, you know, start going more and more and more, automatically they'll pass it. We will be passed by. This whole scenario will pass us by. So we keep working on that. Keep working on that. It's not time to slack right now. It's not time to slack off. It's not time to slack off. Keep pushing this. Keep focusing on it. Keep hearing it. And I'll try to do the same. Who knows what's going to happen? Everything, my environment remains the same. Everything remains the same. There's nothing really changing about my situation, but who knows? Who knows? I said August is moving time. Maybe it will be. We'll see. But certainly we're getting our wheels aligned properly so we can get the push towards the loss-free experience where no resume padding is possible, because we've given up. We realized, time to give that up. That was a non-starter from the very beginning. So, all right, very great. Brought it in under an hour and a half. And we'll keep on, keep this, advancing this narrative, all right? Keep advancing it. Very great, that's it.